Welcome back to Kiersti's virtual classroom. Today we're going to be talking about an introduction to what physical geology is and some of the scientific method processes. So here are some examples of what geology would look like, and we'll get into the breakdown of the sciences. So the sciences cover the social sciences and natural sciences. And then within natural sciences, we have physical sciences and biological sciences. Within physical sciences, we have physics, chemistry, astronomy, meteorology, and geology. And the earth and space sciences are referring to astronomy, meteorology, and geology. Okay, so we're over here with geology. So what is geology exactly? So geology is the study of the earth, its processes, its materials, its history, and any effect on humans and life in general. So we're talking about volcanoes, plate tectonics, earthquakes, soils, groundwater, a lot of different things, a lot of different processes that we see on Earth. So here are a few, but they are not limited to this. So we'll talk about rocks and minerals in this class, faults and earthquakes, landslides, groundwater, fossils, all sorts of fun things. Why do we care about geology? Well, as you've probably seen some of these natural disaster movies like San Andreas or Dante's Peak is one of my favorites. If you haven't seen it, I recommend it. It's a volcanic eruption video. But so volcanoes erupt, earthquakes occur, and people can die as a result of those items or those earth processes. So we want to make sure that we do everything that we know we can to try to prevent death. We cannot prevent these earth processes from happening, and we cannot predict them yet. So we do have a lot of information as far as precursors to some of these events, but as of right now, we cannot actively predict and or prevent these processes from happening. So the more we know about them, the better we can prepare ourselves. All right, is it just rocks? A lot of people hear geology and they think, oh, it's just rocks. Well, rocks are important because that's how we build things. If you didn't know, a lot of the river rock that comes out of the Kings River is blended up with cement to make concrete. So a lot of the concrete around Fresno, Clovis area is from rocks that we pull out of the Kings River. There's also petroleum. So petroleum is a huge industry, as we all know. When we pay gas, it's really expensive. It's a huge, huge industry. You can make actually a lot of money as a petroleum geologist, but you need to be in an area where they actively extract petroleum. So a lot of times this is referred to as the black gold because it is a hot commodity. It's needed in almost every industry, and everybody needs it for their cars unless you have an electric car. So it's really important. It's really big in Bakersfield. If you've never been down to Bakersfield, you'll see a lot of these wells that are actively pumping petroleum out of the ground, out of the soil. If you ever got a degree in geology, what could you do with it? Well, you have fun camping trips like this where you overload a truck. This was one of my favorite camping trips, and things start falling out. but you can be an engineering geologist, petroleum geologist, make a lot of money. Geophysicists, you can study law even, you can be an environmental lawyer, paleontology, which is a study of fossils, volcanology, which is volcanoes, seismology, or seismologist, they can study earthquakes and the effects of those earthquakes, geochemistry, which is basically working in any chemical lab, and there's a lot of other things. Obviously, I am a teacher, I used to work in industry in Fresno, which was doing a lot of groundwater soil contamination cleanup stuff. So there's a lot of different things that you can do with the degree if you ever wanted to become one. And in 2019, there were about 1.8 million people that graduated from college with a bachelor's degree in something. But if you break down those numbers, only about 0.2% of those were earth or physical sciences. So there are a lot of people getting degrees in business, social sciences, and there's more demand right now for a science degree because not a, very many people are graduating with science degrees. It's getting a little bit better, but you have a higher chance of being able to get a job out of school if you get a science degree. That's my little plug for now. But you also get a lot of money. So as an accountant, you can get paid about $53,000 on average a year. Geologists can make a little bit more, upwards of 80 to 100,000, depending on what type of geologist you are. And it also depends on the area. So in Fresno, I wasn't making as much money as I could have in the Bay Area. Bay Area would pay me probably almost double what I was making in Fresno. But cost of living and everything has also increased there, so you have to take that into consideration. So you can get paid basically as much as a civil engineer. Okay, and we have awesome jokes. So here's some jokes for you. You'll get the first one probably once we talk about metamorphic rocks, but gneiss and schist are two types of metamorphic rocks. And I think I have this one in your syllabus probably. So those are just funny little plugs. All right, so moving on into the scientific method. So these are the components of the scientific method. You've probably seen this plenty of times before, but it's just kind of a review so that you know that this is how we are going to go through the class. So first, you want to determine the problem. So what problem are you faced with? Then you want to make a hypothesis from that problem. So your prediction as to what you think the outcome will be. You need to test the hypothesis using experiments. You'll analyze those results and then you'll draw conclusions. Okay. So here's that breakdown here. So we have observation and measurements. This usually happens right around when you have your problem. Then you get into your hypothesis, so what the explanation of this problem might be. Your experiments, this is your testing. Then you maybe develop a theory if you do enough experiments. And then maybe it's a fundamental relationship in nature that you're observing, which will then be a law. So like the law of gravity is a fundamental relationship in nature that describes every time I drop a pen, it's got a 99.9% chance if I'm on Earth that it will fall. All right, so step one is observations. So these can be things like things that you sense or tools, so sight, smell, touch. Observations are really, really important because in geology, we're looking at rocks and we're looking at minerals, we're looking at different things in the field as far as the relationship between how those rocks are interacting. And your ability to make those observations is really important. So being able to see what I'm showing you or what I'm describing to you is very important. So some things that you might see in like every day would be like, why did the water rise when the candle went out? Or why does the only half the popcorn bag pop when I put it in for 2 minutes? Things like that are your observations, okay? So then you're going to form your hypothesis. So based on whatever observations you have made, you're going to try to explain that observation. So it tries to predict or determine what an outcome of an experiment was. So the only half of the popcorn bag will pop for 2 minutes because it takes 3 minutes to actually pop all of the kernels in the bag. Okay. So we have an if-then statement. So if I put the popcorn in the microwave for 3 minutes, then all of the popcorn kernels will pop. Or in this example here, if I drop a rock, then it will fall down towards the ground, which describes the law of gravity, right? Okay, so a hypothesis must be testable. So you can't make a hypothesis and then not be able to test it. That's why popcorn is a good example, because you can actively test that, right? In your lab, you will use ice cubes, but you'll make an observation as to which ice cube is going to melt the fastest, and then you'll make a prediction as to which one. So if I put let's say water on the ice cube, it will fa it then it will melt faster than, let's say, putting nothing on the ice cube. Right, then you're going to test it. So we have controlled experiments that are used to test a hypothesis. This tests only one factor at a time. So if you have multiple variables, which in our simple example, there won't be lots of variables for you to test. You'll do one at a time, and that helps keep it under control so that you know what is affecting what. So one of the things that's interesting with what's happening now with COVID is we don't have a lot of controlled experiments going on, right? We do one thing and then we don't wait for the results of that before we do another thing. So that gets into a whole other topic, but you want controlled experiments so you know what factor is affecting the outcome of your experiment. Okay, so you have things like control groups. And this allows you to see the, like I said, the change in a variable and what that does to the outcome. Okay, so with the variables, we have independent and dependent. So independent means they are being changed in the experiment, but not by the experiment. So dependent is what is responding to a change in the independent variable. Okay, so for an example, growing plants with different amounts of fertilizer. Okay, so you're going to use different plants, but the independent variable is the fertilizer. So, we try to design experiments that clearly show whether a particular variable caused an observed outcome. So, if it can't be observed, then it can't be tested. So, you want to make sure that whatever you are testing is observable. If you can't measure an observation or witness an observation, for example, then you can't test it. You have no way of knowing. So sometimes we use models to represent something in the real world. If it's something so big that we can't test it on a small scale, we make models of basically the real thing or the real situation that we want to solve a problem for. So like plate tectonics, for example, is so big that we have to make models or computer models to actually test some of these things. Okay, so then you want to collect, organize, and analyze your data. So your data is collected from multiple experiments. We will run through one experiment, but when we do this in real life, when scientists actually are running through the scientific method to try to prove something or disprove something, they run the experiment multiple times. That way, when you do your analysis, you're not basing it off of one experiment one time, right? So multiple experiments are conducted, and then oftentimes they are conducted by different people, so that there's no observation bias. Okay, so you would organize your data in tables, charts, and graphs so that you can easily analyze them. And then you would draw some conclusions. So you're going to decide whether the results of the experiment support the hypothesis you originally had or not. And if it's not supported by the test, then you might find another explanation or you might rerun some tests. But no experiment is a failure. So a lot of times in like labs, when we're in person, students will not see exactly what they thought they were supposed to see. And that's okay because every experiment is just your observation. So not everything that we do, and not all of the laws and theories that we have are true 100% of the time. There are experiments that do not prove whatever hypothesis or whatever theory we have. And that's science, and science is constantly evolving. So don't ever feel like if you didn't see what you were supposed to see that your experiment is a failure. Okay? So then you would communicate your results. So you would tell other scientists your results by either writing a paper, doing a presentation. A lot of times they do a lot of collaboration before they even get to this point, just so that they know that they're not putting something out there that is easily falsified or easily proven false. So this helps us develop better theories and better laws by scientists kind of collaborating and putting their results out there and showing what they've been doing to solve specific problems. Okay, so this gets into developing theories. And theories are explanations for some phenomena that we observe. So we have like the theory of evolution that most people are aware of. The theory of plate tectonics, a lot of the geology processes that I will discuss are all going to be theories because they are not 100% or very close to 100% provable. There are a lot of tests and studies done that get us to this point, so it's really hard to become for something to become a theory. But we still call them theories because a lot of them, because they're geologic processes, they take a long time to occur, so we can't actively witness it happening. So we can actively witness an earthquake, right? But as far as what causes an earthquake, plate tectonics, it's hard to actively observe the plates moving because they move so slow. So we do have measurements and recordings, but it still sits in this theory category. And then laws are, like I said, something that is fundamentally, that describes something fundamental in nature. So that would be like the law of gravity. They're not the same as theories because the law only tells you what happens, not why it happens. Okay, so the law of gravity is not telling you why something's happening, it's just telling you that every time I drop the pen, it's going to fall if I'm on Earth. Okay, so these theories and laws are well accepted, but they are not set in stone. They are constantly being revised, and more research is coming out, and we are using the new information that we observe and new tests, new things that we discover, and revising all these theories and laws. It takes a long time for these things to happen, but they are not necessarily set in stone.